Yeah, well, it's kind of wet. I'm guessing. Hey, how are you, Terry? Good morning. Yeah, he usually comes Saturday nights when he comes, but yeah. Okay, checking the sound.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
And this is, I'm going to call it a gathering of people who either don't melt or have umbrellas. Okay. And hello, Mike and Vicky and Art. I took a peek at some of the people online. Today's gospel lesson is about a blind man called Bartimaeus coming to Jesus, and he thinks he's pursuing God, and it's really actually quite the reverse. God is pursuing him. There'll be a little bit of sign language in the sermon. It's unavoidable on this one. And we're going to start just jumping right in with the first hymn, "When to Our World the Savior Came," 551. To hear the words of our baptism In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I will go to the altar of God,
to God my exceeding joy.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
Holy and gracious God, I confess that I have sinned against you this day. Some of my sin I know, the thoughts and words and deeds of which I am ashamed, but some is known only to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask forgiveness. Deliver and restore me, that I may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, by his authority and by his command, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Psalm 96. O sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, bless his name.
Tell of his salvation from day to day.
Declare his glory among the nations.
His marvelous works among all the peoples.
For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
He is to be feared above all gods.
For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols.
But the Lord made the heavens.
Splendor and majesty are before him.
Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples.
Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name.
Bring an offering and come into his courts.
Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness.
Tremble before him, all the earth.
Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved.
He will judge the peoples with equity.
Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice.
Let the sea roar, and all that fills it.
Let the field exult, and everything in it.
Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy.
Before the Lord, for he comes.
For he comes to judge the earth.
He will judge the world in righteousness.
And the peoples in his faithfulness.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. And we sing.
Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. To God on high be glory and peace to all the earth. Goodwill from God in heaven proclaimed in Jesus' birth. We praise our
Holy, you only are the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the helper of all who call on you, have mercy on us and give us eyes of faith to see your Son, that we may follow him on the way that leads to eternal life. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. Our Old Testament lesson for today is taken from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31. We read verses 7 through 9. Thus says the Lord, sing aloud with gladness for Jacob, and raise shouts for the chief of the nations. Proclaim, give praise, and say, O Lord, save your people, the remnant of Israel. Behold, I will bring them from the north country, and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth, among them the blind and the lame, the pregnant woman, and she who is in labor together, a great company. They shall return here. With weeping they shall come, and with pleas for mercy I will lead them back. I will make them walk by brooks of water in a straight path in which they shall not stumble. For I am a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle is taken from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 7, beginning at verse 17. For it is witnessed of him, that is Jesus, you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. On the one hand, a former commandment is set aside because of its weakness and uselessness, for the law made nothing perfect. But on the other hand, a better hope is introduced, through which we draw near to God. And it was not without an oath. For those who formerly became priests were made such without an oath. But this one was made a priest with an oath by the one who said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind, you are a priest forever. This makes Jesus the guarantor of a better covenant. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But he holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He has no need, like those high priests, to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people. Since he did this once for all, when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men in their weakness as high priests, but the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we rise and we sing.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
They came to Jericho. And as Jesus was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent, but he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said to him, "Rabbi, let me recover my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated, and we continue with our next hymn, 574, Before the Throne of God Above. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The text for the sermon is the gospel lesson, and by the way, we will wander into the other two lessons along the way. But from the gospel lesson, the last two verses. And Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said to him, "Rabbi, let me recover my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. The heart and core of the gospel lesson, that is the healing of blind Bartimaeus. But there's something behind it, because as it is with all of the miracles, there's always something behind it. And at this point, I have to give you a little bit of sign language information. In the language, there is a timeline, and it runs like this: past to future. In the past, the future, and one of the signs is forever on into the future. But in sign language, you ask, why? Why is blind Bartimaeus being healed? Why? Why? And the language divides in two directions at that point. Two answers to why. One is because, and because goes backwards into the past. And the other answer is for. For what purpose? What's the goal? What is the intent for doing these things? And that's into the future. And in this gospel lesson, those two aspects are absolutely insisting on coming to the fore. Why is it that blind Bartimaeus is healed? Well, because undergirding this healing, there are the prayers of Jesus. Coming before the miracles, there is the intercession. And Jesus prays. This is a pattern for his ministry. Early in the morning, going out to a lonely place, he was there and he was praying, and they were searching for him. Finally come across him. That's in Mark chapter 1 even. He ever lives to make intercession for us, to say to his Father, "I want this one in my kingdom. I want this one as my brother or sister. I want this one walking with me through the ages of eternity." He is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he ever lives to make intercession for them. And this is the big stuff. The miracles are the little things. The situation and condition in life is the small stuff. That's the piddling things. The question actually is, what's your relationship with God? Because what's your relationship with God is something that God has designed and he has planned, and he had it in mind when he created Adam and Eve, that they would know him and walk with him and have fellowship with him. It's the entire why of why Jesus came into this world. Because he came to save us, because we needed him, because we needed an intercessor, a great high priest. So the character of the healing. The character of the healing is very strange, even in the Gospel of Mark, where there are quite noticeable differences in the patterns of healing. This one What do you want me to do for you? Rabbi, let me recover my sight. All right, done. It's very summary and without any details. You know, going into the reading of this in the Gospel of Mark, you're kind of hoping to see Jesus do something like lay his hands on Bartimaeus. Or then there's the one man who Jesus laid his hands on and asked him if he had begun to see, and the guy says, I see men like trees walking. And Jesus does a little bit more, and then his sight is clear. Hoping for some details, but no. Rabbi, let me recover my sight. Go your way, your faith has made you well. Quite remarkable. It's almost as if this had been in the works for a while. Which actually is the truth of it, isn't it? Jesus knew Bartimaeus. He knew Bartimaeus long before that day. Bartimaeus did not know him, but he knew Bartimaeus. And Jesus had been waiting for that meeting. How long had Jesus been waiting for that meeting? Since before the first dust of the earth. That's some long planning. And Bartimaeus thinks he is pursuing God and seeking a miracle and seeking healing. That may be his angle on it, but no. God was pursuing him. God had been arranging things in his life for the sake of that meeting that day, so that Bartimaeus could not only receive sight, but receive that call into a relationship with God, which would be eternal. God had been pursuing him and leading him through what one hymn in our hymnal calls devious ways, to bring him to that moment of meeting with Jesus in order to bring him into the eternal relationship. And underlying all of that, here's some more, because preparation for this, Jesus is our great high priest. We need him. We need him so very desperately. We need him to be our intercessor. We need him to speak for us before his Father. But before we go a step further on that, define that. And it is not like Jesus goes in front of his Father and pleads, because his Father's all reluctant to have us brought into the kingdom of God. That's not how it is. Rather, there is this perfect unity and harmony, and Jesus praying for us and interceding for us. He has the heart of the Father sort of rooting for his prayers, welcoming those intercessions, ready to say, yes, my son, yes. And so Jesus intercedes for us. We needed him to be our intercessor. We needed one like him. We needed an intercessor who is holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, exalted above the heavens. And you know why we needed an intercessor of that type? Think about it. Think about how much sin and evil there is in the world. We needed this one who could be the holy and innocent sacrifice, the sufficient atonement for the sins of the world. to offer himself up once for all, as the epistle says, Hebrews 7, once for all, as the one sacrifice that is absolutely perfect and able to cover all of the sins of humanity. I'll define that a bit more, okay? Consider how much sin there is all around you in the world. It's rampant. And realize that Jesus has borne the sins of all. Then, think about where that evil has touched your life and the lives of those around you. Sins that have become personal. And realize that Jesus also carried every one of those sins, every offense against you, even the sins of your worst enemy are carried by Jesus to the cross. And then you look in the mirror and you understand that you also have sinned against others. And Jesus carried those sins. And you look inside and you see hidden depths of evil in your own soul. Some of it hidden from others, and others of it hidden from even yourself. And those sins also Jesus carried. Even the ones you don't know are there. One sacrifice, once for all, absolutely perfect. And so Jesus comes into the world and comes to Bartimaeus. And he has a thing in mind, that Bartimaeus will live forever and walk with Jesus in all the ages of eternity. That's the plan. It's the same plan as why he came into this world for you. But I met a man. This was 30-some years ago. Met a man visiting as a pastor. And I went to see him and he said, "Preacher, I don't need anything of what you're peddling today." Okay. As a young pastor, that'll get your attention. I stuck around long enough to say, "Why exactly?" And he told me. He said, "World War II. I was on a battleship and it got shot out from under me and I was there in the water and I called out and asked God to send somebody to pull me out. And he did. And time went on and it happened again. And I asked him to send somebody to pull me out, and he did. So, since he's done that for me, I don't need anything else." Well, that was kind of strange. You see, when God does miracles, when he answers a, what I call a first article prayer, a first article prayer is for the things of this body and this life. It has to do with creation and the wants and needs of the body. First article prayer, and usually for healing or for some sort of this world deliverance. But whenever God answers one of those prayers, there is a for what? for what purpose? God has something in mind. And what God has in mind whenever he answers a first article prayer is to also give a second article blessing. What's a second article blessing? And that would be a relationship with Jesus Christ and the forgiveness of sins and eternal life given, earned not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood and with his innocent suffering and death. Always, always without exception, when God answers the prayers for this world needs, he has in mind that his relationship with us will deepen and grow into all of eternity. So over in the Gospel of John next door, kind of, we've been studying on Sunday mornings, John chapter 5, there's a healing at the pool of Bethesda. And Jesus warned the healed man, sin no more that nothing worse may happen to you. He has in mind, there's a goal, there's a purpose. And it is always to call to follow him and walk with him. Not to leave the relationship with God as only this world blessings. So notice the exchange again. Rabbi, let me recover my sight. Go your way, your faith has made you well. And the gospel lesson finishes with, immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. Always the something more. He doesn't want to give his blessings for this world only, for this life only. Although those may be blessings for decades, close to a century, but that's not long enough for God. He thinks in terms of eternity. And so prominent is that in the way that God does things. So important is that relationship that is eternal that there are even times when there are troubles and curses of this life to bear that he will use to lead us into his blessings that are eternal. So Bartimaeus lost his sight so that he could have that encounter with Jesus and know salvation. Fellow I know of who wrote a bunch of books, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, describes spending decades in the Soviet prison camps so that he can see Christians living their faith in impossible circumstances and then say at the end, thank you, Gulag. Without you, I would never have known God in this way. And there are so many others around the world who go through this life, who face the problems and the curses that come along in this world and learn to turn away from the temporary blessings and to see what God really has in mind, which is an eternity of blessings. And so, Jesus came to pursue and call and win us for God, for the kingdom of God, for being with him forever. The Old Testament lesson says, behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth among them the blind and the lame, and so on. He declares it. A beautiful verse from Malachi. Malachi 3:17. God says, "They shall be mine, says the Lord, in the day when I make up my treasured possession." And it's personal. Because Jesus, talking with his Father, says, "Father, I want them to be with me." And it's built into promises. Isaiah 43, "I've called you by name, you are mine, says the Lord." So much that at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus takes the name of God, I am, and between those two words, he puts a promise, with you. So that literally it does not read, I am with you, but I with you am. He is the with us God. And so here comes Bartimaeus. And Jesus is ready. And Jesus is calling him. And calling him into the kingdom. And here comes a young man named Saul, persecuting Christians and riding into Damascus to find more Christians to persecute. And Jesus is ready. And Jesus is calling him into the kingdom. And Jesus is ready. And Jesus is calling. In Jesus' name, amen. We rise. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the true faith in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. We continue with our creedal hymn, 941, "We Praise You and Acknowledge You, O God."
Oh,
beside your glory were born, a virgin's womb were crucified for us and were placed into a tomb. Then by your resurrection you won for
And you may be seated as we continue in our prayers. We are praying for the family of Sharon Benner. Her funeral was on Wednesday of this past week. Remember to pray for Harry Benner in your prayers. They knew each other from 4 years old. Also Phyllis Lund, who is now in hospice care. Pray for her. We have some additional prayers. Sammy under health and healing. Sarah under ongoing prayers. And we go to our Lord Jesus, bringing our petitions with us. Lord Jesus, Savior and friend, our Lord and our brother, we come to you bearing petitions, asking you to watch over the family of Sharon Benner, to be their comfort and their peace, that they may know the promise of salvation and eternal life and the rest that Sharon has in your Father's house. Comfort them, dear Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And asking for Phyllis Lund that you would watch over her, strengthen her faith as she prepares for your call to come from this world and to find her rest in you. Sustain her. Strengthen her by your word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Watch over the many among us in need of your healing mercies. As we pray for Jerry, Harry, Phyllis, Jody, Judy, Adolph, Dick, Byron, Connie, Ray, Kurt, Colleen, Adam, Joan, Dwayne, Anita, Sarah, Penny, Kurt, and Sammy. You are the great physician, Lord. You know each of their needs. And we ask you to be by their side, guiding them through times of trouble, leading them to doctors and nurses and those who are able to help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask for our loved ones who have ongoing personal and medical needs, for Phil, Cindy, Augusta, Linda, David, Dina, Reagan, Milt, Megan, Christine, Paige, and Sarah. Guard and keep them. Sustain them in their various trials. Be by their side, strengthening their faith through all that they must endure. Giving healing. Healing of body and of soul. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our loved ones in nursing homes, assisted living centers, and who are homebound, asking to watch over Tina and Jody and Art, to give your blessings day by day, and so that the greatest blessing may be your own presence, to be with them and accompany them day by day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask for our loved ones in the armed services, that you would watch over them, watch over Mitchell, Blake, Lisa, Christian, David, and Brian, sustaining them and guiding them, watching over and guarding them, that in every day of service to their nation, they may live in service to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Asking for our nation, that you would guide the leaders of our nation, because without your wisdom, we have no wisdom. Without your guidance, we wander aimlessly. Watch over the leaders of our nation and guard and keep the pastors and Christians in Afghanistan and around the world who name your name, though it is dangerous, who worship you, though it is at the risk of their lives, and allow their dedication to inspire us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We ask for our missionaries, for those involved in Hispanic ministry, for our missionaries reaching out to those in the Middle East, for deaf ministry in our nation and throughout the world, that your gospel may spread to all nations and into all languages. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us, Father, for we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, risen, ascended, and glorious, who has taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen.
Our final hymn is O For a Thousand Tongues to Sing, verses 1, 3, 6, and 7 of hymn number 528.
Praise the glories of my God and King.
And there are some announcements. Our Zoom Bible study, we're in Judges chapter 5, which is the Song of Deborah. And when you get into the songs of the prophets and the judges and whatnot, that becomes an interesting, more in-depth look at some things. Next week is Reformation Day. So we're saying wear red, like Dan has on. Yeah, Dan. Yes, early. And Operation Christmas Child, a reminder. The boxes need to be returned no later than November 14th. We will continue our Bible study. We're in John chapter 5, a fascinating, fascinating chapter in the Gospel of John. Uncommon things are said there. Okay. So, Deb's father, Kurt, has come home. Having had a stroke, he's in recovery. They were able to go to church today. And that's very special. Okay.